नमस्ते, गुड मॉर्निंग, ग्रीटिंग्स टू ऑल आवर व्यूअर्स. आई अदिति पुराणिक ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द सोशल साइंस डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सिटी प्राइड स्कूल निगड़ी वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस लाइव इवेंट, अ वेबिनार ऑन फंडामेंटल राइट्स एंड ड्यूटीज एस्पेशली फॉर द यंगर जनरेशन. एट द वेरी आउटसेट I would like to thank you in advance for the 90 minutes that you're going to be tuned in and spending with us. As an audience, let me remind you that you can be seeing and hearing us live. Also, you can ask your own questions about the topic in the Q&A section. So, coming to the topic, we have gathered today on the 26th November towards the celebration of Constitution Day or Samvidhan Divas. Did you all know that until 2015, this day was celebrated as the National Law Day? In 2015, the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment renamed this as Constitution Day, and since then, this is celebrated throughout India as an attempt towards increasing the awareness in the citizens about the Constitution and their fundamental duties. But does this all look very serious to you? Frankly, this is not, until and unless you tune in and listen to this webinar carefully. Wo picture mein tum log jaise bolte ho, the dialogue that goes, kanun ke haath bahut lambe hote hain, and that is because the Republic of India is a democracy, right? We follow a certain rule book. We go by the law, and the ultimate book of all these laws on this land is the Constitution. And who better can talk to us on this than a practicing jurist himself? So please join me, children, in welcoming Advocate Pushkar Patil sir. Pushkar sir practices as a lawyer, criminal side in Pune Sessions Court and Bombay High Court. He is a master's degree in commercial law from Glasgow University, Scotland, and holds qualifications in housing law, corporate law after completing his LLB from the ILS Law College, Pune. Beyond his success at work, he is an avid cricket fan and has groomed himself to play the T20 cricket representing the team Mumbai and Dadra Nagar Haveli. So welcome to this distinguished guest, esteemed speaker and lawyer. Pushkar sir, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. First of all, thank you the Social Science Department of City Pride School for having me as a guest on your webinar today and giving me the opportunity to enlighten all the students on the topic of fundamental rights and duties for the younger generation, which I was told. So before I move towards explaining as to why today's day is celebrated and how the Indian Constitution matters to each and every person of this country, I would like to open the slide first. Can you see the slide now?
Just a minute.
Yes, sir, we can.
Yes. So just to give you a brief explanation before I move into explaining the Constitution of India, I'll make it very simple. I practice in criminal side and I usually deal with all the criminal matters, although each and every law has to be read in accordance to the Constitution of India. Now, how Constitution of India matters. So basically, going to the next slide. Yeah. So basically, today's day was celebrated as a tribute to Dr. Honorable Shri B.R. Ambedkar Sahab and also to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Now, when India got independence, there were two acts which were enacted. The first act was given the authority to India. The second act was given the authority to Pakistan to have its own independent state, own independent country. And all the princely states within India were given the authority to either accede to India or accede to Pakistan, or they could choose to get independence. So on this noting, since from except Jammu Kashmir, Junagadh and except Hyderabad, all the other states which are now in India immediately joined India after independence, but with efforts from Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, who helped accede 562 princely states. Now, a huge number and has taken a lot of time. So when India introduced the Constitution of India, prior to introducing that, we were the dominion of India. And similarly, Pakistan had dominion of Pakistan. Now, this dominion of India was basically based upon the entire law of British Act. And British Act treated Indians as a subsidiary, as in slavery. They did not have the independent rights. They did not have the decision-making rights. They did not have the administrative rights. Now, since the Constitution of India was introduced by Sri Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar, with the help of other eminent jurist and legal representatives who made it possible. And if you all may be knowing, the Constitution of India is the lengthiest procedure of any country to enter into democracy. And India today, including Pakistan, are known as a common law country. So whichever country that was ruled by the Britishers is known as a common law country. So that is the background as to why the Constitution of India took place, because we did not want a settled principle of British law to move ahead. We wanted an independent democratic state. We wanted a democracy that could pass on to each and every citizen, irrespective of his caste, region, color, anything. And since you already know that India is a vast country having various religions, and the only source that could have brought together each and every citizen of this country was through the Constitution of India, because there is no other legal independent document. Now, the Constitution of India is basically the roots of any law. So if tomorrow the legislative wants to bring in some law, as in say, if tomorrow they want to say that the children of this country who belong to a specific religion will get education in specific field, then that law is illegal and it is void ab initio. So what is void ab initio? That is, it is not in accordance to the basic roots of Constitution of India, and therefore it is illegal. So let me make it clear, whichever law is introduced, it has to follow the basic principles of what Constitution of India articles are. So moving next. So today, 5 years ago, the Honorable Prime Minister of this country, Shri Narendra Modi ji, on 19th November, declared today's day to be celebrated as the National Constitution Day for India. Previously, as ma'am told, that it was celebrated as the National Law Day. But today's day is celebrated to give tribute to Honorable Baba Saheb Ambedkar and also to Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel, because of whom today we exist. Now, a short history to make it interesting. Initially, when India started inviting the princely states to be the part of the country, the Nizam of Hyderabad had refused to join India and had threatened that he would go to Pakistan if he is not given the independent status. And subsequently, what he did was, on that very condition, he tried to persuade India to keep its focus on Jammu and Kashmir. And on the other hand, he started increasing his own military, which were known as Razakars. And Razakars, what they started to do was, they used to enter the rest of the India and they would create atrocities among women, among children, among other people, because Nizam at that time and Hyderabad at that time were pro-Muslims. And the option was left open to all the countries by the British government while existing, whether they want to be a part of India, which was previously a Hindu state, or Pakistan, which was a Muslim state. And since geometrically Hyderabad was in the center of India at that time, so it had no other option than to be the part of India. Because when Razakar started creating atrocities, the Indian government sent its own military troops upon the Nizam, and Nizam eventually surrendered. And the same goes with the Junagadh, because Junagadh, the Prince of Junagadh was a Muslim, but the residents of Junagadh were all Hindu. A referendum was called upon in Junagadh, and with a majority of 83% voting, they acceded to India. So that was the easiest victory for Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel, who was the then Home Minister. With regards to Jammu and Kashmir had its prince in Hari Singh. Hari Singh was a Hindu, but 71% of the population at that time approximately was Muslim, and they all wanted freedom. The issue that we have today in Jammu and Kashmir was that, including Hari Singh, all the residents of Jammu and Kashmir wanted independence. They did not want to accede to India, and they did not want to accede to Pakistan either. But eventually a trade deal was given, a trade deal option was given by Hari Singh, because Jammu and Kashmir being the center line of Pakistan and India, they gave an option to both the countries to accept their business proposal, in which they did neither wanted to be friends or enemies with Pakistan, neither wanted to be friends and enemies with India. Pakistan accepted the deal through Mohammad Jinnah Ali Khan, but India did not accept that deal. India gave a counter letter that you send your best person who could discuss upon the deal to crack, as in whether you want to accede or not. But Raja Hari Singh did not initiate anything. He, in fact, on the contrary, told Pakistan that he will have a friendly relation with Pakistan. And Pakistan thought, as in misrepresented, misinterpreted, that they wanted to join Pakistan, but because of the pressure from India, they are not doing so. And since Jinnah wanted a Muslim state, he tried to send military troops into Jammu and Kashmir, thereby forcing Jammu and Kashmir government to approach India for seeking military help. And Raja Hari Singh, in year 1954, kept certain conditions in which he stated that Jammu and Kashmir, as long as the Constituent Assembly exists, will have a special status, as in it will not be entirely the part of India. And eventually, as you all know, in the year 2019, the Indian government abrogated the Article 370, thereby making Jammu and Kashmir the entire part of India. As to how that was done, that is a big issue, and today's lecture would not be enough to discuss that case law. So basically, abrogation of 370 has now made it possible that Jammu and Kashmir is part of India, although there are several petitions that are pending in the Supreme Court. So as of now, let us just hope that Constitution of India is the supreme authority and Jammu and Kashmir remains the integral part of India as it is, because that was the condition of Raja Hari Singh, was that as soon as his Constituent Assembly dissolves, automatically Jammu and Kashmir will be part of India. So coming to the next slide. So whether Constitution of India is a supreme authority, so by now you must have got it clear that to bring in any law or to make any policy, any administrative policy, legislative possibly, the roots have to be from the Constitution of India. So if tomorrow any government introduces, any government as in the state government, introduces any sort of act, authority or law, but which supersedes, as in goes beyond the framework of Constitution of India, that is to be held illegal. So just to read you a part of here, the Constitution is the supreme law of India. It is enacted in such a way that it has its roots of all the existing laws in the country, and no person, no politician, no other authority, no politician also includes the Prime Minister of India, the President of India. No other authority, no department, and no human being is above the Constitution of India. That is, the law is supreme, and our law of the land is the Constitution of India. Then this is a question that mostly comes into UPSC examinations, the fundamental duties. Now, today's topic was on fundamental duties and rights. So to short you down, there are 11 fundamental duties and 6 fundamental rights. Now, what is this fundamental duties? It is the basic duties, but the list is not exhaustive, as in although there are 11 of them and I have mentioned the 9 important ones out of here, this is not exhaustive. It is extensive and it is to be interpreted. So the basic fundamental duties are to abide by the Constitution and respect its ideals and institutions, the national flag and national anthem. Now, most of you might have known that in cinema halls, when we go to watch a movie, there is national anthem. And there has been a lot of debate in the past that most of the people do not stand up for the national anthem. And there has been various discussions as to why national anthem is necessary in movies, in theaters. So the idea was that the Film Institute of India thought it that to give its contribution towards the nation, they introduced the national anthem, but the Supreme Court eventually has stated that fundamental duty is upon the citizen to adopt it, and we do not live in a country ruled by a king. So it is upon the people whether they want to stand in the national anthem or not, because merely standing in the national anthem does not denote whether they are for the country or against the country. But as a human being, as a personal opinion, I would believe that you should stand for the national anthem, because we have a long history of struggle and we should give the tribute to all the soldiers and all the politicians and eminent people who have brought the freedom to us. Because if you go through the history, it is extremely painful, and my grandfather being an army person, it is disheartening upon him if nobody stands for the national anthem, because they have given their lives for the country. So the next is to cherish and follow the noble ideas which inspired our national struggle of freedom, as I said earlier, to uphold and protect the sovereignty, unity and integrity of India. So why this point is important? It's because tomorrow, if any sector of the country, as in say hardcore liner sector of the society, decides to spread false news, false propaganda, false agenda, they might try to provoke the country, a particular section, then there are going to be riots, because not every person of this country knows the law. So basically, it is stated that even if you do not know the law, indulging any sort of activity that is against the state is not your duty. Your duty is to be peaceful, influence others to be peaceful, and remind others that you are a person of this country and whatever you do is for the betterment of the country. So to defend the country and render national service when called upon to do so, to promote harmony and spirit of common brotherhood amongst all the people of India, transcending religious, linguistic, and religious or sectional diversities, to renounce practices derogatory to the dignity of women. So I'll be coming why as to this point is important for the youth of today's generation, and how the Constitution of India has played an important role as to bringing the bridge between the youth and this law. That is very important. So to value and preserve rich heritage of our composite culture, to protect and improve the national and natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers and wildlife, and to have compassion for living creatures. Now, this point is important. As you all know that if you have been closely following the news channels, there has been issues regarding the car shed, I hope RA car shed in Bombay. So they wanted to remove that forest part and to bring there the metro station, but which was opposed upon this law. Because that is our national duty. It is our fundamental duty to preserve the forest, and merely for the betterment of the public, it cannot be taken out. So to develop the scientific temper, humanism and spirit of inquiry and reform, to safeguard public property and abjure violence. So if you have been again closely following the news channels, whatever happened in the Delhi riots is all cause and action of how the fundamental duties are absolutely not been in accordance to the Constitution of India, and the repercussions, as we see, that the court has to intervene, and the police authorities were also involved up to some extent in creating the violence. So that has been coming out right now. So it is essential that you keep a watch on the news also, because that is how you enter the adulthood as a part of the country, and you should know how things work. To strive towards excellence in all spheres of individual and collective activity, so that the nation constantly rises to higher levels of endeavor and achievement. So it is your prime duty, not just that if you choose any kind of a stream. So me being from legal field and only respecting law because I am a lawyer, it makes no sense. It is my national duty to be respectful towards the country and its countrymen. So I request you all that these are the fundamental duties. There are total 11 fundamental duties. So that is a question that comes in UPSC also. And the list is not exhaustive. It is interpretative. There can be many several fundamental duties that you can have. So going to fundamental rights. So basically there are 6 rights enshrined in the Constitution of India. So from Article 14 to Article 32 are all the rights, but in a collection of bracket, which is the right to equality, right to freedom, right against exploitation, right to freedom of religion, cultural and educational rights, right to constitutional remedies. So I'll be sharing the PDF with Aditi ma'am, and to whoever is interested in having the copy of this PPT can ask Aditi ma'am to get the copy of the same, because see, the list is far too long and the lecture does not permit me to go beyond due explanations, as I have to only give you the background. So sure, this sir. Section, this section is also been covered in ahead in the later part. So to give you a brief idea, right to equality and the reason why the youth are directly involved is because it includes the equality before law. The prohibition of discrimination on grounds of religion, race, caste, sexual orientation, gender or gender identity or place of work, equality of opportunity in matters of employment, the abolition of untouchability and abolition of titles. So the reason why the present article was introduced was because India prior to independence and even after independence has been facing various cases where the acts of untouchability are still taking place. I believe you all must have seen the movie Article 15, which has given a brief idea as to how the caste politics and sexual preference has been working in India, which is a drawback of the nation. But see, we come from slavery, as in we were slaves technically. We cannot say that we were merely a country ruled by an alien country. We were slaves because we did not have any authoritarian rights. We did not have a free speech. We did not have independent government unless and until the Britishers left us. And when they left us, they gave us a piece where we had to join each and every cube on it to create its own building. So the difficulties were faced at the time of creating of law because, as I told you earlier, merely introduction of Constitution of India was not the only challenge. The challenge was to invite other princely states. So the challenges have been many because we were left in shambles. Now we have come a long way, but still there are sections of the society who are still engaged in such activities. Now, caste politics, as you may all know, there are several politicians who tried to spread filth in the country by making statements online, which again is against the Constitution of India. But since that generation is now moving out and this new generation gets an opportunity to enter the new world, the more you take part and the more you participate in the lawmaking process, freedom of speech, it is going to be a changed country. So it is minimum basic that you should be respectful towards the Constitution of India, because Constitution of India is you and it is going to create the nation ahead. So if you be respectful to the Constitution of India, the fundamental rights are all yours. But if you are against it, then that may also amount to acts of sedition. Now I'll come on that part after the pros and cons of freedom of speech that I'll be discussing ahead. So right to freedom of speech and expression, assembly, association or union or cooperatives, movement, residence and right to practice any profession or occupation. Now, why do you think the point was introduced? It's basic because since we were previously ruled by Britishers, all these things were not available to us. The only freedom of speech that we had was to conduct peaceful protests, but with the permission of the government of British ruled administration, which again, they made it difficult. So what we have, this right to freedom, is the most important right, and Article 21 of it, which is right to life and liberty, is the most important, with a short minimum definition which I'll be discussing ahead. So right against exploitation prohibits all forms of forced labor, child labor and trafficking of human beings. So this trafficking of human beings is because India, even after the Britishers left us, there were several other alien countries that tried to again persuade us, invade us through various means. Now, what were these means? If you have been closely watching the news channels, the children in Tibet, Nepal and all the northeastern country region, they are still today trafficked into foreign countries, Dubai, Saudi Arabian countries, and they are treated as slaves, sex slaves, human slaves. Their body parts are taken out. And there are minimum reporting on the issues, because the problem again is, once you take a birth, your registration as a citizen of that specific country is important. But if that is not there and your country does not have the count of its own population, then all these things take place because this is the business that has been taken place even in India. And if you have seen some movies wherein it is suggested that children should not go out alone, this is the reason why. Because the whereabouts, it is so difficult to trace out the whereabouts. Even the police machinery becomes limited because we do not have that advanced technology in police machinery as well. So right against exploitation. So if you ever come across any such things, it is your prime duty to inform the nearest police station. So As a good Samaritan, good citizen, you should always carry the phone numbers of the nearest police station. You should always have the phone numbers of the commissioner of police. You should always have the phone numbers of your teachers, because that's where you can inform. Maybe some parents won't be interested to listen out, because that has been the case. And I deal with those cases where the parents are like, you are going to the school, let your teacher handle it. So your teacher is your next parent. So be sure that you share whatever you come across, because that is going to create a social security. And that's how you will also be feeling safe. So right to freedom of religion. So if there is a Hindu and he wants to celebrate Ganpati Utsav, he's free to do it, because these rights weren't possible. Although India was created on the concept of having a Hindu state, India has made sure that each and every religion practices its own religion, can have its own God, can have its own belief, can have its own form of prayers, can have its own form of language. And if you are to believe me, the Constitution of India has been drafted in over 56 languages in India, including Arabic. So that is how India works. So we have to do some things for its betterment. Then cultural and educational rights. So preserve the right of any section of citizens to conserve their culture, language, as I told earlier, or script, and the right of minorities to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. So if I may tell you, the law that has been operating in Pakistan, the country has only 2 to 3% of Hindu population. The rest of the Hindus were forced to either convert themselves from 1976 onwards. So very little quantity of people, but they cannot challenge the laws introduced by the government. So that is their law. Or even though that country is a common law country, they have its own constitution and they have adopted the British policy. Of course, we also run on the British policy, but the Constitution of India works entirely different on what one minority can do. So a minority, howsoever small, has the right to raise their voice in India, of course. So right to constitutional remedies. So Article 32 is very important article as to why, because if any right, from right to equality to right to educational rights, from Article 14 to Article 30, if any person of the society, irrespective of his caste, religion, sexual orientation, anything, if he feels that his right has been taken away by the administrative authorities of India. Now, administrative authorities of India, as in the police department, medical department, or any department that works directly under the government of India, then he can directly approach the Honorable Supreme Court under Article 32. So Supreme Court a couple of days ago had issued a statement that they are trying to discourage the use of Article 32, and all the media houses were targeting the Supreme Court as to how can Supreme Court say that is the fundamental right and it is the protector of all the laws and rights that we have. But it is misinterpreted. The Honorable Supreme Court meant that unless you exhaust all your rights at your own level in the lower courts, only then you can come in the Supreme Court. That was the interpretation which was misconstrued by the media houses. So basically, before you utilize the Article 32, you also have several remedies, such as approaching the police. If the police do not listen to you, you have the authority to approach the honorable courts. If the lower courts do not hear you, you have the authority to go to the high court. And if the high court doesn't listen to you, then you come to the Supreme Court. So that is the interpretation. That is how the system works. Because if every person starts coming to the Honorable Supreme Court, then nobody is going to get justice, because the cases are going to keep on piling. So that is not how the law works. So coming next. So focusing on the topic as to freedom of speech, what are the pros and cons? So initially, when we were under the British rule, no person had the authority to have his own opinion unless the government had. Now, whose government was it? British government. So if they permitted you to talk upon some point, only then you will raise your voice. If they did not give you the permission to protest, you are not to protest. And the punishments prescribed by the British government were so harsh that one could not imagine residing in such state. I'll give you an example. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, in the year 1926, protested against the tax, as in the tax was quadruplicate. Four times more tax was imposed upon the farmers, and their lands were taken away by the government of India, who were Britishers at that time. So he raised the voice. Although the protests were peaceful, he was thrown behind the prison for 3 years, only to speak against the government that you are taking away the bread and butter of the farmers. So that is how the situation in India was. And that is exactly why what we have today is a gold in our hand. So what are the pros of the freedom of speech? It ensures public opinion based upon decisions by government. As in, if tomorrow the government of India says that from tomorrow onwards, the school going children will also be paying taxes. So will you be raising your voice or will you be paying the taxes? Of course, you will raise your voice because you already know that students aren't earning, their parents are earning. And from where will they pay taxes if they are not earning? So this is where you have the authority to raise the voice. Then can speak what one feels like against the administration, legislature or executive department. So basically these three departments are the government, the courts and the police departments and the politicians. So you today, you have the right to speak against any of the department unless it is within limits that should not exceed a language that can amount to foul language. So comments passed in good faith are guaranteed. So what are the comments passed? As in, if tomorrow you are walking on a street and you see a person who is misbehaving, you are free to call him that this person is misbehaving. But if tomorrow a person is walking, is obese, fat, and you are putting blame on his, look what a fat guy is walking, now you are crossing your limits because that is disrespect. So comments passed in good faith, oh, he is fat. Okay, I agree. The tone matters. So this is how the pros of freedom of speech works. Unless and until you are speaking in good faith, it is permissible. Can be a part of peaceful protests. So as I told earlier, not to break the public property, because your parents, who are the taxpayers, and including the teachers who are paying the taxes, are part of creating India, including each and every penny that they have adduced for the development of this country. So make sure that in future, if you plan to enter politics or plan to participate in any protest, make sure that they are peaceful. Ensure diverse opinions. So in school also, if you may see that if two people are talking and you might be supporting Virat Kohli, somebody else might be supporting Sachin Tendulkar. Just because Sachin Tendulkar has become old and that somebody else's opinion does not matter. That is not freedom of speech. But another person could have another opinion. Maybe I might be liking Ashish Nehra, who knows? So ensure diverse opinions. Everybody has a right to their own opinion and you should respect that. So discourages anarchy or forceful decisions. So freedom of speech is a wonderful section, because if tomorrow Modi government, as in the government of India, present government, brings in a law that despite this pandemic of COVID, the student of city pride school will have to attend the school compulsorily. That is a forceful decision. Why only us? Now that is against the constitution of India. So that is how the law works. You have to protest for it. And that discourages anarchy and forced decisions. So can bring forth the problems of society and enable introducing changes. So how it brings the problems of the society? As in, if the government introduces any law which extends only to a certain kind of a society, as in if tomorrow they bring in a law that crowding in Ganpati festival is not allowed, but then crowding in Eid is allowed. So you have to raise the voice. So why one law for one community? Why the other law for another community? So that is how you bring ahead the freedom of speech. Then social cyber platform to reach out to other countries. So most of the students over here might be having their fake accounts on Facebook because they haven't completed 18 years of age. That happens. I am a part of it also. So you can post anything on your social media, but make sure that is within the permissible limits. And you have to guide your parents, guide the elder persons in the family from not posting such things, because that things could amount to sedition, that things could amount to defamation. As in, if you do not know the source of the information and you are posting it on the Facebook or social platforms such as WhatsApp, you're spreading messages, then that could amount to sedition, that could amount to defamation of any person, and that is punishable by law. So making the use of cybersecurity for your own freedom on good faith is permissible. Similarly goes with what you share on Facebook. Now, sharing pornographic images, sharing bad articles which do not have the source, sharing any fake schemes, spreading false news, religious troubles, all these do not come under freedom of speech. They are rather the cons of freedom of speech. A form of recognition. If see tomorrow you are raising the issues of the society and you are reaching out to the people who haven't been heard and you are being their voice, then it gives you a form of recognition. Maybe you could be a reason a new law could be enacted. So that is the proof of freedom of speech. Then scope for creativity and artistry. So in India, what happens is most of the serials that are being shown or the media houses or the movies that come, sometimes there is this limit that they cross. And that makes things difficult because your freedom, although guaranteed under the Constitution of India, it has to be in good faith. So there are limits, as in you are free, you have the freedom, but in limits. So I hope you understand that. Then the cons of the freedom of speech, crossing limits, as I told earlier, that the opinions could land oneself in acts of sedition. Sedition is basically if the government of India introduces some kind of a law and you are not happy with the law, you can protest it peacefully. You can have your opinion. But if you start abusive language, you start blaming a government without the source, then you are committing acts of sedition because that are against the country. So baseless opinions, as I told earlier, without the source, are punishable by law. And then comment passed in bad faith. So I'll tell you, if you have been closely watching the news, a YouTuber made allegations of the Sushant Singh Rajput case against Akshay Kumar without having any source. And Akshay Kumar filed a defamation case of 500 crore rupees against him. And he immediately apologized. Now, why did he apologize? Because he knew he did not have the source. Now, that is the con of freedom of speech. You have to be very careful, because if you do not have the source, don't post it. And Wikipedia on Google, it is the weakest form of source because that can be edited by any person. So talk to your elders before you do something, talk within your friends and use good language, because again, that bad language is going to land you in trouble. So aggressive protests amount to offenses against state. Excessive protest destabilizes the settled norm. Now, why this is important is because just because the government you do not like is making decisions and their every decision is being opposed, then that is going to destabilize the government. And there is going to be eventually nothing will work, as in no law will be implemented because there is repeated protest from the society. There has to be a internal way, as in you have to support the good things, you have to oppose the bad things. But if you keep on opposing each and everything, then that is going to destabilize the government as well. And that is against, again, working against the country. Then delays procedure meant for society as large covers the point. Then misuse of cyber world, as I told earlier, that you have to be very careful using the cyber world because hackers and cyber crime are the new technological crimes that are being committed in India. Then could spread negativity against the state, as I told earlier, sedition. And sedition law, now the government of India has also introduced the UAPA Act, which means that if you do not agree to the decisions of the country, then you could also be labeled as a terrorist. So although there have been various debates on the law and today's lecture would not be sufficient to cover that as well. So make sure that whatever you post online as of now or whatever opinions you hold, they are in good faith and they have source. Then coming to the next point. Now, Article 21 of the Constitution of India, protection of life and personal liberty. The definition is very small. No person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to procedure established by law. But Article 21 is the vast interpretative section ever in the Constitution of India. Now, how? Then I'll read some case laws. I'll discuss with you some case laws which will be important. The first one being right to die. Now, I'll go to the previous slide first. First, protection of life and personal liberty. And what does the case law say? Right to die. Now, whether right to die can come under right to life under Article 21, conflicting views, right? So the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Aruna Ramchandra Shahanbagh versus Union of India has decided that passive euthanasia can be allowed under exceptional circumstances under the strict monitoring of the court. And there is a storybook on the case, Arunachi Goshta, Aruna story in Marathi by Pinky Virani. So I'll discuss this case, as in it is a very interesting case and it directly involves the youth of the country. So I don't exactly remember the years of the story, as in the case when it took place, but I'll tell you the story. Aruna Ramchandra Shanbhag was a nurse, senior nurse, and was working in Bombay. And she was merely 21 years old. And a sweeper boy on contract basis in the same hospital committed rape upon her. And he tied her neck with a dog chain. He strangled her neck and he forcefully committed rape upon her, thereby damaging her spine, lower spine, hip bone, thigh bone, even the chest bones. And she went into vegetative state for 37 years. She was on ventilator for 11 years out of those 37 years. That is the most painful any person can go. And all because that sweeper boy committed acts which are against her choice, her will, and she did not consent to it. But many people, many NGOs, including Pinky Virani, approached the Honorable Supreme Court that the lady who is on bed since 37 years, at least give her the right to die, because merely she is living without any purpose. She does not talk, she does not listen, she is only in bed in KM hospital and does not even move. There is constantly a pipeline in her nose. The pipeline in her nose was also so robust and rust that eventually it had to be changed after 10 years. That is the most painful story any person can undergo. And why it is important? Because she was merely 21 years old. She was also young, like you people. And nobody raised her voice. Nobody else took initiative as to what to do with her. Even the Supreme Court failed to intervene in the matter. Eventually, the poor soul died with pneumonia in the hospital. And the Supreme Court stated, when it realized a three-judge bench was set up for deciding the case, and they decided that a passive euthanasia. Now, a passive euthanasia is sort of an forceful death given to mostly the pets. If you have a pet at home and it is undergoing any problems, then the doctor advises that it is better to give him passive euthanasia and kill him instead of keeping him in such painful state. So that was given in this case, and the most painful story, as in if you start reading it, your throat will dry. That is such a bad case, as in one could only imagine what she had undergone. So I would recommend you all to go through this story, Aruna Ramchandra Shanbhag, most painful story of India. And this is directly related to the youth. So then right to die is a fundamental right now, but only in exceptional cases, as in where it has become impossible for a person to even survive. Then under the guidelines of the Bombay High Court now, with the directions of Honorable Supreme Court and under the observations of the appropriate hospital authorities, government hospital authorities, passive euthanasia can be given and a person has the right to die. Then right to human dignity. Now this covers the entire Article 21. Now it paved way for right to clean water, right to clean air, right to freedom from noise pollution, standard education, speedy trial, fair trial, right to livelihood, legal aid, right to food, right to clean environment, right to medical care, and everything out there, including right to choose a life partner. So why this is the most important landmark case in the history is because, as I said earlier, now again, we'll have to go to the definition to explain you properly. It is stated, no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to procedure established by law. And what did the case of Maneka Gandhi do? Maneka Gandhi wanted to travel to another country. Just before her travel, the state government withdrew her passport and impounded her passport and told her not to go outside the country. She was humiliated on the airport. She had no idea why her passport was impounded. She then approached the Honorable Supreme Court and told that it was a political move and only to cause harassment to her dignity, this act was done. The Honorable Supreme Court then called upon the state government and sought reasons as to why it was done. The state government had no specific explanation for the same, and that gave away the way for interpretation of other rights, such as clean water and clean air, as I read earlier, and it is the landmark judgment. So better go read, covers everything, because in that case, the Honorable Supreme Court had stated that any law, any act or any decision taken by the state government has to be in accordance with the Constitution of India, and it cannot be passed arbitrarily. So if tomorrow your principal says that XYZ person is not to come from the school from tomorrow, you have to ask the reason why, because that is unconstitutional and nothing of such sort can happen against you. Of course, unless you have committed some acts which go against the policy of the school, but the school has to give you the explanation. Similarly, in a way, if you have to have a complaint against any of the teacher, that has to be with reasons. If you go and keep on complaining about some teachers, then you are causing harassment upon their right. So this is a landmark judgment. And then moving on next, right to privacy. So if you all have been following the news regarding the Aadhaar card protection case, as in whether the Aadhaar card is mandatory for government offices and making the government accessible, then there are conflicting orders in the judgment. Aadhaar card is compulsory. Let me be very clear. In the case of Justice Puttuswamy versus Union of India, Justice Puttuswamy was himself a retired judge, 93 years of age. He was told to give his biometric for Aadhaar card, which he refused. And he approached the Supreme Court that his fundamental right is being hammered with, because the data that is being stored at the web portal, if tomorrow the government website gets hacked by any alien country, then it is going to make it very difficult that his personal space will be safe, because it is going to get invaded, as in the biometrics that you give for the Aadhaar, they are going to be misused up against you. Now, if tomorrow the government decides that the data is to be sold to another country or a private firm, every day from morning to night, the private companies will try to contact you. You will not have your own personal space. You will not have the freedom. Now, that is harassment, and there are conflicting judgments, two opinions. First thing, very clear, Aadhaar card is compulsory, but the government is not to store your data for purposes of commercial reasons. So both are important, and in that Supreme Court judgment, the Honorable Supreme Court of 9 bench have decided that right to privacy is a fundamental right. What you do behind the closed doors, what you have your personal information, personal assets, personal business, personal benefits is your private information, and that the government does not have the right to get engaged into, unless of course the activities are illegal, prima facie against the Constitution of India, and needs interference of the police. So right to privacy is your fundamental right. Then how does this all interrelate to the younger generation? Now I'll go point by point, because these all are important. The first is to be careful in using internet and related social media. Now I'll tell you why it is important. There was this case in Punjab that had happened. A 17 years old boy tried to follow a 13 year old girl. He took out her photograph and morphed the images with naked pictures of other women, and he circulated those images. This is a case of course, 4 to 5 years ago. In that case, when he was arrested and the police questioned him, because that was easily traced, he told that he tried to propose the girl and she said no. Now, these are the events that happen in school. If you approach any girl and that girl is, as in saying you a no, that is a no. Her consent is not there. You are not to invade her private space. And if you subsequently enter into such activities, then the law is very strict. The punishments are up to 20 years of imprisonment, which you may kindly take care of. And of course, discourage any such things if they are happening in the school. And first of all, your students, why approach a girl at this young age? First, do something in life. Then raising voice against child crimes such as ragging, molesting and committing acts of crime. So in school, if you have seen, be very vigilant. If tomorrow any person from outside comes, including the staff of the school or any person of the administrative authority comes and they try to do anything, molest you, rag you, if there are elder seniors that are ragging you, inform your teachers, because this is against your constitutional right. You have the right to move freely. You have the right to move with personal liberty, and no senior authority has a right over you. The only right you will ever have until adulthood is your parents. So make sure that you know about it and you raise voice against it. To be creative and encourage the growth within the society. Now, this is a normal trend. What happens is usually when you come across the social media platform and you like something, you download it, you share it, make sure that you create something out of it positively and not just label it as your own work, because it is somebody else's work. So if tomorrow you copy a quote of say a prominent jurist like Subramanyam Swami, if you copy something of some of his writings, then make sure you give him the credit. Or if you are inspired by his work, create something and then make show it as your work. So be creative within the society and encourage others to grow. To raise voice through the teachers, parents and police persons, as I told earlier, you should have the important phone numbers of your teachers. You should have a complete address of your home. You should have the important phone numbers of the commissioner of police. You should be also aware whom to contact in difficulty. And now, since most of the schools are permitting the children to carry the mobile phone for emergency purposes, make sure that you store all these numbers and learn at least a few by heart. You never know when you would I have to refer them. So knowledge about nearest police station, as I told earlier, to remain vigilant and be a participant. So if tomorrow you come across any such illegal activity, as in from going to school, from coming to school, while playing, anything, make sure you remain vigilant and be participant, because maybe your right won't be getting hammered, but somebody else's is. And maybe somebody else might not be so strong to raise his voice. So you have to be his voice, unless, of course, you do not be a Bahubali and go and fight yourselves. That is not your job to do. To learn about good touch and bad touch, I guess your school has already taught you regarding the good touch and bad touch, because to all the younger children, mostly girls, this is very important. You better learn what is a good touch and bad touch. And to be really honest, the touch of an unknown person is really not necessary. So if anything of such thing happens, inform your teachers immediately. So there have been cases about school molestation which are gruesome to even hear. So make sure you inform your teachers. Then to learn about social duty and social morals. So there are these two things: social duty, as in keeping the environment clean, then touching the feet of your elders. These are all things come under the duties and morals. See, you have to maintain your cultural space. So if you do not like to bend down to somebody and touch his feet, as in what we have in the Indian culture, it's okay, it's fine. But that does not mean that you are also given the authority to disrespect that person. So there some things are social morals which you may not like, but you have social duties which you have to follow. Social duties are directly related to the fundamental duties. Social morals are what your parents are teaching you. So if you are uncomfortable with the teachings of the parents, follow the teachings of your teacher, no problem. But your social duties are going to be your prime obligation to follow, not the social morals. That is a big difference that you have to follow. Just because if tomorrow you go to the temple and there have been instances where as in sacrifice of goat is being made, you don't like to make a sacrifice of a goat, don't do it. It is not forceful upon you. That comes under the social morals, that the cultural morals. So it is not compulsory upon you. But social duty, yes, you have to follow it. To treat others humanly and humbly, I've covered it earlier, that give respect, take respect. To be respectful for others' opinions, as I told earlier, one person can have some other opinion. You have to be respectful towards that. And the most important point, vote when you turn 18 years old and above, because your vote matters. And you are the reason of the participation. If you do not vote, then a government is going to come who is trying to destabilize the constitution of India. So vote and make your voice raise. So I guess all in all, it was an informative lecture. And thank you. So I'll hand over to Aditi ma'am.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much. With the examples and the cases which were so appropriate, I'm sure that they all have, so many things piled up to ask. I will move to the question answer session now.
Okay.
There are a few questions which are posted. beginning with one of the question that Harshdeep Kakde has asked.
Okay.
He says, sir, you have told that everyone has the right to approach the Honorable Supreme Court.
Yeah.
If we don't get proper justification in the district and high court.
Right.
But you also said that if all cases are handed over to the court, Supreme Court, mm-hmm. there are very less chances of the cases to be solved. So
right.
why the government filter, mm-hmm. why does the government filter the lower and the high court system so that the citizens are not forced to enter the Supreme Court? So
this is a very vague statement to make, because eventually there are high courts to decide, and there are benches of high courts, dual bench, triple bench, who can also decide the cases. So not approaching the high courts and directly approaching the Supreme Court, that means you distrust the state government. Now, if you want to go directly against the state government, then at least solve your remedy. You cannot be presumptive, as in if tomorrow I have a problem with my state government, then I have to approach the high court first, because that is the procedure established by law.
Sure. Yes. So they are saying, or I guess the question meant to ask that mm-hmm. lower courts, like the high court or session courts or district courts, mm-hmm. that the citizens are, I mean, what measures do they have so that the citizens are not forced to enter the Supreme Court or go directly and approach the Supreme
Court? See, there are technically five types of writ petitions that you can approach. So one is habeas corpus, one is certiorari. There are various writs under which category you can approach. So to give you an example, if tomorrow a person is been arrested by the police without him committing any crime and without there being any sort of first information report filed against him, and he's still being kept in the custody of police, you can directly approach the high court first. And under High Court, you have to approach under Article 227, wherein you will be stating you will be calling upon the police station to bring the person before the court as to why he has been hidden, as in why he's been in custody. So that is your first right. And the police are bound to respond to the same immediately. And that is punishable offense. Even the police can get suspended. So in that case, if the lower court, as in the High Court, decides to not entertain your petition, then you have the remedy of approaching the Supreme Court under either special leave petition under Article 36 or under Article 32 to safeguard your fundamental rights. But since the high courts and the Supreme Courts are interested with the protecting of fundamental rights, you have to first approach the Honorable High Court in such cases.
Okay, sure, sir.
And law being the independent department, as in it does not come under the government.
Autonomous.
State government.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Sure. I hope that they have good answers to what I mean. He had a very good answer to what he was trying to ask. So thank you for the answer. The next question is that if a rally of Ganpati or any festival is creating a lot of pollution, do we have the right to oppose it?
Yeah, you have the right to oppose it. But the rally will also have the right for their cultural freedom. So once, if you have the right of noise pollution, your remedy can be solved by the nearest police station, who will give them the permission for a limited time. If they cross their limits of that limited time, then you have the right to approach against them. But make sure that they also have the right of their cultural freedom.
I understand. So everyone's freedom at the same time. Correct.
Right.
One more interesting question, sir, is that what about the Arnab Goswami case going to the Supreme Court right now?
See, true. I wanted to discuss this case. Arnab Goswami came to be arrested in an old case. Now, I'll tell you the procedure. When the case of 306 of abatement of suicide was filed against Arnab Goswami, initially he was called upon for interrogation. He went to the police station. The police did not find sufficient proof against him. So they filed an A summary report. A summary report, B summary report, and C summary report. These are technical terms of criminal procedure. Now, without going into the detail, when a police officer files summary report, it can be either closed, partially investigated, subject to reopening, and partially investigated, but subject to reopening with the permission of the court. So these are the three things. So out of which the police filed initially that this is open to investigation. And upon that basis, the case was reopened. Obviously, there has been some hand of the government, as in the Supreme Honorable Bombay High Court in the Kangana Ranaut case has itself stated that the government is acting against the interests of the public. But there are courts. And if the courts weren't vigilant, such observations wouldn't have been made. So Arnav Goswami first approached the district court for bail, which came to be rejected. Then he approached the High Court, which came to be rejected. And then he approached the Supreme Court. So Supreme Court is not directly involved. And Supreme Court, what has tried to make sure is the law of bail is with context to those people who have the possibility to run away from justice. Now, a person like Arnav Goswami, whom we watch on the TV and has been residing in India since a long time, is a citizen of India, has been residing within the local limits of police station. What was the urgency to arrest him? The police could have easily given him a notice to appear before the police station. That is not done. You are not giving him an opportunity to approach the court for anticipatory bail. That is why the Supreme Court has interfered, as in a case in which you already closed the procedure, you reopened it without giving him the opportunity. Now that sounds some fishy.
Okay, sure, sir. I hope children, you're paying attention to the types of FIR or the technical details also here. So for the further things, the next questions would be according. The next question we have is, does the court or does the Union of India permit anyone to have euthanasia?
Frankly speaking, apart from the Arunas case, till today there hasn't been any other case in which it is permitted. But there are instances in the Aruna case itself. Aruna did not have the first relative, as in she did not have her mother, she did not have the father. By the time the court was being decided, her family had already died. So in those cases, the law works as in the first relative, as in the first blood relative to the person, will have the authority to approach the Honorable Supreme Court. Now in this case, Pinky Verma was merely a journalist. So the court did not label her as the first relative, but the court gave the authority to KM Hospital as her first relative after considering the facts.
Okay.
And initially the Aruna's case, that was rejected twice. It was rejected by the Bombay High Court. It was rejected by a 3-judge bench of Supreme Court. And then it was referred to a larger bench who decided that a case in which a person being alive is still dead, then what kind of a right to life are you providing him? Because right to life also gives the right to dignity and right to die with dignity. So as on today, there are no such cases where the passive euthanasia is permitted. But I believe there will be cases in future, because considering the pandemic situations, most of the people have also undergone vegetative state. Now that is a subject matter for the Bombay High Court, as in to entertain such petitions. But the Honorable Supreme Court in that case has given specific directions that only with the permission of High Court and under the observation of the senior most doctor of the government hospital, passive euthanasia can be given only to certain cases where there is no scope of the person returning to normalcy.
Sure, noted. Thank you for that. Next question is that, sir, why was the preamble changed in urgency or in a haste in 1975 if the preamble was supreme?
In context to?
They are just asking why was it amended? Like we all know that there's a right to constitutional remedy or changing. A question about.
Generally speaking, whenever an amendment has been introduced, why is it introduced? Because more and more sections of the society keep on adding to the Constitution of India. Now, if you are to believe me, Goa until late 1970s, I believe, wasn't an absolute part of India. And if you read the Constitution of India, initially, all the sections have diluted Jammu and Kashmir. As in, the statement begins with the article extends to all the rest of the states except Jammu and Kashmir. Now that term comes to be amended. As the society has been progressing, similarly the amendments have been carried out. So preamble can be amended as long as it is with the accordance of its own document, as in the Constitution of India. So there is no bar to it. Legislation has the authority to amend it.
Sure, okay. So as the long as minimum majority and quorum that it meets in the parliament long, after that.
As long as the Constitution of India is given kept the supreme authority, it can be amended. And amendment does not dilute it.
Okay, thank you, sir. Next is a, I would say, a right to freedom type of a question, where they're asking if can a Muslim party rule the country in the future?
Well, it depends on whom you vote. So if, that's why I told earlier that your vote matters. Now, if you go on the lines of caste, then that is, then your opinion, if you consider him as a human being, as a citizen of India, irrespective of what religion he comes from, then yes, there is all possibility. If there, that there wouldn't have any possibility, Dr. Abdul Kalam Saab would have never been the president of India.
Perfect. True, sir. Very true. Next question is, if as an individual, he or she is not satisfied with the judgment given by the Supreme Court, what can I do?
You can make an appeal to the Supreme Court itself to raise the issue before a larger bench. But if the larger bench decides against you, you do not have any remedy.
Okay, okay. Next question is, sir, you've said earlier that we can go to the Supreme Court if lower courts do not, you know, give you the judgment as you desire. So is there a chance, again, a related question, I would say, that the case gets handed over to the International Court or the UN?
See, there are two things. Whenever the laws introduced by the state, now I'll give you an example, that if the border dispute is with there with Pakistan, or there have been atrocities within India. So if you all know that the Gujarat riots case in 2002, there was gross violation of human rights. Now that case came to be referred to the International Court because there was violation and atrocities upon the human rights. Now, if India tomorrow goes and faces problems of human trafficking, then it can be referred to International Court of Justice because we have signed the accord to be a part of International Court of Justice. And only those countries who have been a member of United Nations can approach the ICJ. But not an independent individual. The government, either the opposition party, an NGO, any person that has a point proving that there have been problems against human trafficking, human atrocities, or nuclear functionary, he can approach the ICJ, that community, not an individual.
Okay. Okay.
And of course, the first recommendation letter and the assent of the president is required.
Noted. Thank you, sir. Questions have been flooding in, sir, to be honest. I'm just trying to navigate to the next question. Give me a moment, please. Yes. The next question is, if any person is arrested by the police without having any confirmed reason and the person is punished for it, later, if the real culprit is found, is the police who arrested the person without any reason punished or do they also pay any fine, or is there a punishment meant for them?
I'll give you a short example. If a person comes to be arrested without proof or without a case against him, then that itself amounts to illegal detention. So there itself, the High Court can intervene, and the police will be put to heaviest cost, including the senior officer of that police station, and all the police persons will be, as in, removed from their posts. So the there is the local gangster case. I forgot the name of that gangster. The UP police were engaged in showing a murder as a suicide. As in, he tried to run away and we shot him as an encounter case. They tried to blame it as an encounter case. So in that case also, all the police persons engaged in that activity have been removed from their posts. So the court knows that some fishy activity has taken place. Subsequently, if there is no proof against a person, he cannot be punished, because the criminal procedure works in a way that unless and until there is reason beyond reasonable doubt against the person, only in that case scenario he can be punished.
Okay, and as they say, the court is about the details and the scrutiny, so that will be
evidence.
Proven.
Yeah,
yes.
Evidence. So okay. A person will not be put behind bars, and he audi alteram partem is the concept that no person can be punished without him being heard. So unless and until a case is proven against him, he cannot be punished.
Great. Great. Thank you so much, sir. I really wish I could understand the Latin terms and the legal jargons there. I would request you to leave your email ID with us so that the children also can send their questions further.
Yes,
I would do that in the further course of time. Meanwhile, coming to the next question. These days, there are a lot of things such as not respecting the national anthem or the public property, and many things are many things not being done as per the fundamental duty. This is quite annoying. How are we supposed to approach this behavior or this public behavior?
The easiest way out is to approach the Honorable High Court. You can approach either through an NGO, you can approach either to yourself individually, but your reasons have to be detailed, as in you cannot approach the High Court for something which is already decided by the Supreme Court, because that becomes a law. If Supreme Court decides that standing in the national anthem is not compulsory, then again you cannot approach the Bombay High Court stating that nobody is standing in the national anthem. Then that becomes illegal because Supreme Court has already decided it. Now, if you want to say you want to approach against the environmental law, yes, of course, you can approach. You can approach directly to the Supreme Court as well, because that was the case with the RA car shed case.
Sure. So is this also known as the public interest litigation, PIL?
Yeah, right.
Okay, perfect. Perfect. Thank you. Thank you for the answer, sir. The next question is, there was a case which happened that a man of 60 years was beaten to post a picture of Uddhav Thackeray. So is this legal, or can it be a right for the man also, which would
be good? That is the right for the man, and every person engaged in such activity is liable to be taken into custody under the relevant provisions of Indian Penal Code. And I believe you might be following the case. There already a case of manhandling has been filed under Section 326 against 24 people. Similarly, on the footing, the man who posted it on the Facebook is also liable to be punished because he had no backing, no source. You are engaged in the activity of defaming the Chief Minister. Now, if you are engaged in an activity of defaming the Chief Minister without proper appropriate source, then you are equally liable to be punished under the IT Act as well as for defamation. On the other hand, Uddhav Thackeray and his government cannot be permitted to take the law in its own hand, and they are also liable to be punished because that was the duty of the police officer to do. And manhandling in any case is illegal.
Okay, sure. So coming to the next question, that is visible to me right now. I will navigate to the further ones in the meantime. What is the meaning of the word socialist in our preamble?
Be social. Be inclusive. Short and sweet.
Okay.
Be respectful to others.
Next question is, if the Prime Minister or the President is found guilty in a crime, what does or what is the further procedure done about it, or what?
First he'll have to give his own resignation, or he will be enforced by the present government of India to file his resignation, or the person who is as in the aggrieved party can directly approach the Supreme Court against the policies which have been taken place. So if a president is engaged into illegal activities, the Supreme Court can also direct him to step down from his post, and then he'll be dealt as a normal citizen. A case will be filed against him, and he'll have to follow the due procedure of law.
Okay.
But he cannot be held guilty unless and until a case is proved. And if you are following the recent Supreme Court case laws, tainted politicians, as in previously, as in the ones who have been held guilty of any offense, cannot be eligible for standing as a politician, as in for any posts. Like the case of Lalu Prasad Yadav, He's been convicted and the case has been pending in Supreme Court, and I guess he's convicted there as well. I've not been following his case properly, but he cannot stand as a politician now.
Okay, sure. So they are barred from many other
Conducting
rights,
right.
effect. Okay, further. Okay. One of the questions is that, sir, how can we best make use of the Right to Information Act, RTI?
The best way possible is RTI applies to all the government departments alone, and not any other department. So right to information application cannot be filed against the individual's information. It can be filed against the details of an individual registered with the government. And the best way is to that if tomorrow the government introduces any kind of a policy, any kind of a construction work, any kind of an act, you can seek information about him. Now, there have been social activists who have been filing applications regarding the expenses of the prime minister. And except, of course, the prime minister's fund does not come under the right to information, because that is how the right to information was enacted. Now, if you want to change that, any person will have to first challenge the Right to Information Act before the Supreme Court. And then the Supreme Court will be deciding whether or not that act is illegal. As in the case of Aadhaar card, the Honorable Supreme Court has stated that use of data as in of an individual for commercial purposes is prima facie illegal.
Okay. So that violates the right to privacy in some
right.
areas.
But as far as I would be informing, the decisions with regards to Prime Minister's funds would not come under the RTI in any which ways, because he'll have the freedom to use those funds for the betterment of the society, of course.
Okay, so the PM CARES Fund.
Right.
Okay.
So if that right is given to the individuals, then the opposition would keep on engaging themselves on that. So as I told earlier, that if everything comes under the rights, everything comes under protests, then there will be absolute chaos and the government would not work properly.
True. Is it legal to spread fake information or defame the government, like the liberalists do?
No, that there is a law for UAPA, and there is a possibility that if you indulge in some activities of those nature, then you could also be labeled as a terrorist. So refrain yourself from spreading information that does not have an authentic source.
Sure. Next question is about a person in case he or she is missing for 7 years and then considered to be passed away or dead. So is there so if there is a person who's gone missing or in a hideout intentionally in this time for some illegal act, will he be punished or will he be considered as a dead person?
No, if the person goes missing, then it is true that after 7 years, he will be considered as dead since his whereabouts would not be known. But in those cases, the police will again file the summary report that will be subject to reopening. So even if it is assumed that he is dead and he subsequently comes before the police, then the police are at liberty to reopen the case. But as in liberty, as in the case would be still pending against him. And a case that I did when I was an intern, an accused some Kute from Nagar was found after 30 years. The case against him was closed as disposed since the accused could not be found. But after he was found, the case was reopened and he was convicted.
So
it is again based upon the summary report, and that would require an absolute another lecture for criminal procedure.
Sure, sir. When and how will the not taken up cases or not reachable, this is the same case, I guess, where they are asking about the not reachable or not taken up cases. How are they handled further?
Now I'll give you an example. The Aadhaar card case, Justice Puttuswamy had approached for data protection. Similarly, there were 372 petitions, if I remember the number properly. These petitions dealt with either the biometrics or either the coverage of Aadhaar card for government institutions. Some approached the Honorable Supreme Court for keeping the Aadhaar card not mandatory. Now, some made it approach the Honorable Supreme Court for stating that the personal information is not essentially required because most of the people do not have their own homes. So now what address will they put in the Aadhaar card? So all these concerns, when an issue comes before the Honorable Supreme Court, the Supreme Court will pile up all the collective matters having the same subject matter and dispose of them accordingly altogether. And all the observations will be taken in one judgment. Now that was the same case with the Ayodhya judgment. The three parties approached, three Muslim parties approached the Honorable Supreme Court and prayed for a larger bench intervention. That larger bench intervention was called upon, and similarly four other parties had also approached, stating that no, we do not want the land. But eventually the court had to pile up all the matters collectively and decide one decision, because if tomorrow it happens that some matters are not piled up and the subject matter remains open, then it will go unheard. So if one issue is being taken, all the similar issues of those category will be piled up. Now this is upon the party who has filed the case. It is upon his duty that since one case is already being heard on the subject matter, it is him who has to go and apply that his cases are based upon the same subject matter. If he fails to do so, then the court has given you ample time to do it. Now if you fail to do it, it's your responsibility.
So now we understand why we get tarikh pe tarikh in the court. That is because they are looking into so many details. And I presume where you don't have to, it's not in the conflict of interest for anybody else. So that is what is getting
right.
Sure.
The most surprising thing about this Aadhaar card judgment, if you believe me, the petition I was only 13 pages and the judgment is 279 pages. And with a translation copy of 571 pages. So you know what kind of judicial work the judges are undergoing. Because 68 matters were collectively decided.
Really deep respect for the entire system, because mere reading or understanding the details is a task, of course.
Right.
Moving to the next question, sir, there's one question which is in my mind too, that multiple Indian criminals run away to different countries after doing a crime in India. So what action does the government take in these cases?
India will, with whoever country India is having bilateral ties, there is this extradition request and extradition treaty. So if an accused is with Dubai, for example, India does not have an extradition treaty with Dubai. So if we presume that a terrorist like Dawood Ibrahim resides in Dubai, then India, or even though have made multiple requests for his extradition, the government will not listen to it because there is no extradition treaty. Now this extradition treaties that India have are with Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and SAARC countries. Basically, we do not have this extradition treaty with Pakistan also. So whoever runs away to this, as in countries with whom India does not have extradition request, the person will not be extradited. Now India has extradition request with Mauritius, and there have been in past various criminals who have run away to Mauritius who have been extradited to India. But in the case of Nirav Modi and Vijay Mallya, they went to a country with whom India does not have an extradition request. On the contrary, they are conducting businesses in those countries and providing them funds. So whichever country that like a country like United Kingdom will eventually decide that instead of extraditing, if the person is providing funds to this country, why is there a reason that he be extradited to a country where there is no extradition treaty? Now, even though efforts are being made by the United government also, United Kingdom government also, to extradite him, but there is also Supreme Court, which will decide his rights because he has been conducting business in the country since a very long time. So that country makes him eligible to approach that court, because the policy of that court is that any person who is relatively concerned with the roots of United Kingdom and conducting business. So that makes him eligible that the Supreme Court of United Kingdom will run for his help.
Okay. So actually, sir, this goes into a loop, I guess, and there's a lot of monetary loss also for the public prosecutors to run the case and everything.
Now, I'll give you a short example. There has been, I believe most of you are aware about the Dalai Lama case. Mm-hmm. He's been fighting for the free Tibet movement since a long time. But he found his refuge in India, and there have been several requests from the China government. Because of which China has opposed us in various decisions in the United Nations. That is the same reason we do not want to give him away, because we support Tibet. So we have our own political interests. Similarly, the UK government could have its own. So that depends on the foreign policy.
Again, yes, yes. Next question is, sir, there are many legal eagles in our vast country, but everyone cannot afford them due to their own financial issues. So are there any specific means where the government would provide some good advocates for an issue which is really high intensity and the rights are getting violated?
The Constitution of India has given each and every citizen of India the right to free legal aid. Unless, of course, he is under financial problems. So if a person who cannot afford the legal services, there is legal aid for his help. And there are various NGOs through whom he can approach. There is the court itself. So if an accused is brought before the court and he does not have an advocate, does not have the knowledge, does not have the funds, the court will provide him a legal aid. And every court is set up with legal aid services.
Okay, so they would find them only in the court campus, or is there a way to reach them
through
the NGOs or directly?
Through NGOs also, through directly court also. The court can also call upon the legal aid, and they are capable, as in brilliant lawyers. Trust me, they work their day and night for the betterment of the people. So there's nothing to worry about.
Great. Thank you, sir. Many a times, children have seen child labor in small shops. So, can anything be done for these?
Yes. Yeah. When you come across such things, immediately call the commissioner of police in whichever area you are. So, if you are living in the rural state or in the rural place, you call upon the superintendent of police. That is why I made it clear that the youngsters need to have these important mobile numbers in their mobiles. As in, if you are residing in Nigdi area, you should have the phone number of the Pimpri commissioner compulsorily, his office number. And whenever you come across any such things, you call them immediately, because that is a crime. And the first involvement would always be upon the police, because they are the administration.
Understood. Children, there's also a police kaka or posters that are now pasted in the school campus as an initiative from the police. I guess those are also a few contact numbers that you can keep handy and then tell them that you were at this spot, and then they would take the appropriate action or give you the next contact number.
And your identity is hidden. When anything you inform to the police through mobile phone, they do not disclose your identity.
Sure. So that inhibition ki kyun
isne kiya,
chakkar mein padna hai, and why do we bear the brunt for it, etc. goes out of question. Okay.
For normal things also. So if the children are sleeping in their homes and they are studying for exams, and at late night there is some ruckus on the road, or even their neighbors are creating ruckus, then also they can call the police. And that comes under tort, as in civil tort, an activity which is troubling you because of somebody else's actions and which need not necessarily be legal, then the police can intervene.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir. Last question for the session, sir, that this is again something that is a personal opinion, that they're saying that there are some missionaries which are forcing certain tribes to convert. So is this legal, and why is the police not interfering?
Once again, conflicting view. The Constitution of India gives every part of the society its freedom to conduct its own movement. Now, merely going before some and a group of people and offering them to convert to specific religion is not illegal. It is upon them whether they want to adopt, because inviting somebody in their own religion is not illegal. They are just trying to bring more people in their community, and that is as in that is not banned. We cannot be said permitted. That is not banned. No, there is no law conducting it as illegal. And if you see the missionaries who tried to enforce their religion upon others, that is illegal. But if you are not enforcing and you are on the contrary inviting people, then that is not prohibited. Now, Christian missionaries, there are several Christian missionaries. It is not prohibited. They are offering that if you believe in our God, you are free to join. They are not forcing you.
Sure. Noted, sir. It was an excellent session, sir. To be honest, too many things to grasp. And I would request you to please tell us your email ID. And yeah, I would make an announcement once the preamble is read out, or once we are towards the end of the program. Now I invite upon Anisha Miss, Anisha Pandit Miss, to please propose the vote of thanks and move ahead with the flow of the program. Thank you.
Sound in the background. So just give me a few seconds. Yes, am I audible, miss?
Yes, miss, you are.
Yeah. So on the occasion of the Constitution Day, apart from arranging this webinar for all of you, an important part of the celebration is reading of the preamble of the Constitution and reaffirming our commitment to uphold its ideology. So I request you all to read along the preamble with me on this special day. Even if you are not heard, I would want you to read with me. Miss, can you open the screen? We'll at least keep the preamble on focus. Aditi Miss. Hello.
Sorry, Miss, I was unable to unmute. Just give me a moment. I'm just opening the file. One moment, please.
Yes, Miss.
Can you see my screen, miss?
Yes, miss. I'll just send it live. Yes. So let us start reading. We the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. And to secure all its citizens justice, social, economic, and political liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship, equality of status, of opportunity, and to promote among them all fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity of the nation. In our Constituent Assembly, this 26th day of November, 1949, do hereby adopt, enact, and give to ourselves this Constitution. Now we have come to the end of this program, and the program can never end without a vote of thanks. Someone once quoted that feeling gratitude and not expressing it is like wrapping a present and not giving it. Right now, we all are filled with gratitude and we are not going to make the mistake of not expressing it. As we have come to an end of this informative webinar session, on behalf of City Bright School, management, staff, and students, I take the opportunity to put our gratitude into words. I extend a warm and heartiest thanks to our esteemed speaker, Advocate Pushkar Patil, sir, who spared the time from his busy schedule to grace this webinar with his extremely relevant address on the fundamental rights and duties of the Indian Constitution. Thank you, sir, for enlightening us with your knowledge and thought-provoking insight on the role of Constitution in our lives. You rightly pointed out and explained the social duties and social morals. You made it so relevant for our students. Thank you for answering all our questions enthusiastically, sir. It was a great learning for all of us. You are an exemplary person, and we have a lot to learn from you. Looking forward to tie up with you again, sir, in future.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
It was Thank a pleasure. You once again. Please accept a small token of appreciation from us. Aditi, miss, can you share that? Yeah, you have shared it. Just let me send it live. Yes. So please accept this small token of appreciation from City Pride School.
Thank you.
As and I'm extending, thank you. Can yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you to the social department of City Pride School for having me as a guest lecturer today. And it was really an honor. I could go back to the college memories when I used to read all these details. Thank you so much. It really means a lot to me. Thank you.
I really enjoyed and understood everything, sir. Really, you have explained it so well. And you have entertained the cherry on the cake was you entertained every question, enthusiastically.
Yeah, and I'm sure that the coming generation is as enthusiastic about law as and avid cricket fans like you too. So I'm sure that they've enjoyed that part. Watching you being successful at one part and juggling the other part as well. So I would make an announcement, Miss, to end the session.
I would just end the vote of thanks, Miss, and then you can. Sure. As I'm extending now, I'm giving the vote of thanks. So I would also take this opportunity to express my deep regard and gratitude to our directors, Dr. Ashwini Kulkarni, ma'am, and Dr. Dipali Savai, and our beloved principal, Mrs. Maya Savan, for always encouraging us and providing opportunities to organize such events. I also specially thank our dear supervisor, Nisha Panikar, Miss, for her unfaltering support and confidence in us. My deep sense of appreciation and thanks to all the participants who chose to be live with us and attending the webinar with enthusiasm and made it a successful event. Last but surely not the least, thank you, Sheetal Savant, Miss, for all your technical help. You are not well, but you were there with us to guide us through this, technically guide us with this webinar. And appreciation for Aditi Puranik, Miss, who really anchored it so well, and Social Science Department to organize this wonderful webinar. Thank you all. Happy Constitution Day. Take care and God bless. Yes, Miss.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anisha, Miss. Thank you, Pushkar, sir. As I said, just the announcement part where the email ID of sir had to be sent across. I was trying to send it through the Q&A section, and we will let it out to you very shortly. If not through the live event, through some other means later. So, Miss, if we wish to curtail the program now and end the event, we are good to go.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir, once again. Pushkar, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
I'm sure that if the children could speak, they would have other beautiful words for you too. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank
Teachers
you.
Are the Thank voice. You. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.